my house, we love decorating for Halloween, but we always used to hold back because all that wall damage can be really scary. Well, not anymore, thanks to these Command products from 3M. There are command hooks of all types, so you can hang everything from lights and spooky spider webs to a big seasonal wreath, then easily take it all down with no damage. With Command products, you can have the most haunted house on the block.
Command products from 3M. Throwing a Halloween bash? Check out new Command party hooks in the party aisle.
Well, we just want to give you an idea as to what is happening here at the hotel. Well, come.
Because all that wall damage can be really scary. Well, not anymore, thanks to these Command products from 3M. There are command hooks of all types, so you can hang everything from lights and spooky spider webs to a big seasonal wreath and easily take it all down with no damage. With command products, you can have the most haunted house on the block.
Command products from 3M. Throwing a Halloween bash? Check out new command party hooks in the party aisle.
Hey, morning. I am Robert Solomon for OCTN. We're at the 42nd annual SOUTHEASTERN Lectureship, and we're here at the Grand Ballroom of the Hilton Hotel. We just want to give you an idea as to what is happening here at the hotel. Well, come with me and see what's happening for the 42nd annual State Lectureship. At the point where you enter, and certainly when you enter, you meet some beautiful ladies with beautiful smiles who will make sure that your day is productive.
We just want to give you an idea as to what is happening here at the hotel. Well, come with me and see what's happening for the 42nd annual State Lectureship.
We're right here at the hospitality booth, and we're going to be talking to one of the persons who are involved in making sure that you were greeted with a smile on your way in. Please introduce yourself to OCTN, tell us your name and what role you play in this lectureship.
Hi, my name is Patrice Perry. I'm just here to register, direct everyone where they need to go for the lectureship.
And how's that going so far? How has the response been?
Very nicely, thank you. It's going very well.
You expect a large crowd today?
Yes, I pray that we have a good turnout today. So far, so good.
Thank you so much. You guys have been smiling, decked all in your black, and really smiling all day. God bless you. Let's go to another place. You see a lot of vending in this area. It's beautifully set up, and we just want to introduce you to some of the stuff that's been happening here in this particular area. So we go across, and we have Vanguard Solutions Consulting, and we just want to talk to somebody from here. Good, we're from OCTN, and we're streaming this live. We just want you to talk to us, tell us what's going on here, who you are, and what do you offer.
My name is Roxy Hall, and I'm actually the marketing director for Vanguard Solutions Consulting, and we actually provided all of the marketing for this event. So we did the online registration, we did the website development, we did all marketing.
And in this particular year. So we go across, and we have Vanguard Solutions Consulting, and we just want to talk to somebody from here. Good, we're from OCTN, and we're streaming this live. We just want you to talk to us, tell us what's going on here, who you are, and what do you offer.
My name is Roxy Hall, and I'm actually the marketing director for Vanguard Solutions Consulting, and we actually provided all of the marketing for this event. So we did the online registration, we did the website development, we did all marketing.
And so we go across, and we have Vanguard Solutions Consulting, and we just want to talk to somebody from here. Good, we're from OCTN, and we're streaming this live. We just want you to talk to us, tell us what's going on here, who you are, and what do you offer.
My name is Roxy Hall, and I'm actually the marketing director for Vanguard Solutions Consulting, and we actually provided all of the marketing for this event. So we did the online registration, we did the website development, we did all marketing.
My veins, Lord, it's in my veins. Well, it's in my veins. Again, I want to thank you guys for having me to bring greetings. They had a function, so that to remember to have me here. I also pray for me and I pray for you. And anything, let me know. Thank you.
And this to create Newton's year. Station for your outstanding leadership and dedicated service to our community on behalf of the Churches of Christ in St. Petersburg. Thank you for everything that you've done.
So you can hang everything from lights and spooky spider webs to a big seasonal roof and easily take it all down with no damage. With Command
Products. At this time, we're going to have Brother Andrew Harrison doing purpose, followed by Brother Melvin Shepherd from Fifth Avenue doing prayer.
Participate in it, and to share with you just a minute here so I can try to get to my page. This talk will not be very long because all that I have to say basically is covered in the introduction part of the program. Brother James Kennedy and I, the late Brother James Kennedy and I, back in 1973, met with a group and founded this lectureship, and it has been a blessing to our lives ever since then. And Brother Kennedy has gone on, and we always remember him. And along with him, I'd like to express the gratitude to those former ministers and the active ministers, all of you who are here, to help us make this event a memorable, productive, realistic moment of challenge against sin and all that faces the church. We are living in very difficult times, a declining times. Things are getting worse every day, and the church is not coming up with a counterpart opposition to that. Because we continue to depend on preaching almost alone. I'm a strong believer in preacher. I've been preaching for the Simpson Street Church of Christ for 54 years and will continue to preach as long as I live. But we have got to do something to activate the membership of the church to get involved with their sins and their wrong. And that calls for some hard thinking to come up with something that meets today. But we're in terrible times. So I want to express my appreciation to all of you, members and church leaders, for all that you are doing and all that you are capable of doing to make this program a possibility. That's the purpose of the lectureship. Not for us to socialize, and while we welcome that and enjoy each other's company, we are here for a greater purpose. And I offer you the challenge now that I did earlier today. It is my firm, honest conviction and belief that we are today equally responsible to God as the Christians of the first century were to God. God depended on Paul and all of those disciples to do their will, do his will. And the more they were persecuted, the more profound they became. And I don't know why I would think that God cares more about Paul than he does us. I don't know why we would think that he expects less out of us. The people were the instruments of salvation and redemption in the first century, and they've got to be the same kind of instrument today. We cannot swallow off our responsibility on succeeding generations or ride on the saddle of those who went before us. Now is the time. Now is our moment in history, and God will hold us totally responsible for how we responded to his will. It makes no difference what excuses we make, because the world is going down, and we ought to be working not to go down with it. So that's the hope of this lectureship, that we can do something other than socialize, but meet the problem. And whatever the problem is, we just got to get together and try to come up with some solution. Some reaction, not just sit by idly and let it go. God knows that you and I and we are capable of this. He has blessed us with that ability. He has endowed us. He has assigned us. And if we do not do it, we sin against his will. May God bless you. The great folks, let's get it done. He has blessed us with that ability. He has endowed us. He has assigned us.
Dear God, we come before you, dear God, just thanking you for this opportunity. Dear God, thank you for allowing so many of your souls to meet, dear God. Dear God, thank you, dear God, for allowing so many to come from far and wide, dear God, with all traveling grace, dear God. Dear God, we ask you to be with us at this time, dear God. Dear God, we just thank you for your presence at this time. Dear God, be with the speakers of the hour, dear God. Anoint them, get in the door of a portion, dear God, that you say they deserve. Dear God, be with us, dear God. Dear God, clear our minds, clear our hearts, dear God. Let us receive you. Come before you, dear God. God, we thank you so much, dear God, for the way that you bless us. Despite us, dear God, you are blessed and great, God. Dear God, allow us to hear the wisdom that was just spoken to us, God. Allow this church to be great, dear God, and be in everything that you allow people. Allow us to be better. Allow us to grow from the relationship, God. Allow us, dear God, to put you first in heaven and in them. Dear God, we come before you, dear God, spotted, but we know you are leading, God. Dear God, we come before you, dear God, in need of your help, dear God, and we know you are helping, God. Dear God, we know you are providing, God. Dear God, be with us, blessed. Be with us all week, dear God. Dear God, keep our hands around us, dear God. Keep us safe. Help us admonish each other in love and with us. God, we thank you so much for those who work tirelessly, God, just to put this in. It's been great so far. It's been beautiful. Dear God, we hope that you get the glory from it. We thank you once again. We love you so much. Dear God, we hope these, the praises, dear God, as we speak today, we ask all these things in your Son Jesus Christ's name. Let the church keep us all.
Amen.
Dear God, keep our hands in our lives, Lord. Keep us safe.
All right, now, let's get loose. Let's get ready to give God some praise. Now, we ain't, this is not a funeral service. We came to give God some praise today. So, I want y'all to say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All right, so when the preacher come up, we know how to say it. We know how to give him a little feedback. All right, so we're going to get ready to introduce our first speaker. But before I do, we want to let all young people, all kids, can be dismissed at this point to go to room St. Peter's. All my kids may go right now to St. Peter's room 1 and 2. All right. Our first speaker of tonight, our dream team tonight. We have a dream team lineup tonight. And we've got one that's going to start it off, Brother Xerxes Snell. From 9th Street in Winter Garden, has been at Winter Garden 9th Street for 14 years, has been married to his beautiful wife Lisa for 24 years, has 2 sons and 2 grandchildren. So we want to bring Brother Snell up in a mighty, mighty way. And so I don't know who's going to be leading us in song, but we want to make sure that we bring him up right. And at this time, we have everybody to stand up and get some of that food going down. Let's praise God. And the next voice that you will hear will be a Brother Xerxes Snell from 9th Street Church of Christ in Winter Garden.
Has been married to his beautiful wife Lisa for 24 years, has 2 sons and 2 grandchildren.
Check, check. All right, all right. How everybody doing tonight? All right, we're going to praise God tonight. Amen.
Oh, Lord, I come to receive my blessing, patiently waiting. Oh, for love is in thine. I love thee through the living one. Live to know my blessing shall come. It's mine, oh mine. It's all this time. Oh, Lord, I come to receive thine. And I'm patiently waiting. I believe.
church said, amen. Amen. Again. The Lord has been good to you, say amen. One hope. If you have to receive a blessing, say amen. One more time.
Showed up worthy. Church, think I said something. He showed up worthy to be praised. He's been better to us than we've been to ourselves. We just want to stop by and say thank you, Lord.
Say amen.
It's good to be here in the great city of St. Petersburg, Florida, the 42nd Southeastern Lectureship. What a time we're having already. I want to say from the onset, we want to thank those who have orchestrated this lectureship,
showed up worthy.
Brother Smith, Brother Tucker, Brother Sapp, and all those who have worked worthy with him to be in this endeavor. They have done an outstanding job so far. And praise the Lord, and we just thank God for all who have been involved. I'm thankful to have this opportunity to share my faith in Jesus
Christ
with you.
You can't skip this Geico ad because it's already over. Geico, 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance.
We're just thankful to God to have this opportunity to be on this platform with these great men of God, Brother Jefferson and my friend, Brother Wesley T. Leonard. Tonight, 2 Corinthians. Chapter number 12. We shall begin our reading at verse number 7. And we'll read to verse number 10. If you have it, say amen. The text says, "And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelation, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong." Tonight, I want to talk on the subject, grace for grown-ups. Grace for grown-ups. From the time they were little, all kids, all that they want to do is to act and to be grown up. So much so that there was a movie came out in 1988 starring Tom Hanks. That movie was entitled Big. It was about a boy who was frustrated with being a little boy. And he wanted to be big, so he thought about it and constantly wished that he could share in the apparent good times of all big people. At an amusement park, he came across a strange machine that could grant wishes, and he told the machine that he wished somehow that he could be big. He woke up the next morning to realize that overnight that he assumed the body of a young adult, but he still had a child's mind. He learned fast that it was better to enjoy life as it presents itself to us rather than push life too fast. He searched desperately until he found the machine, and he wished to be small again. Every age group dream of being older. Toddlers dream about being in big kid school. 10 and 12 year olds dream about being teenagers. Teenagers dream about getting their driver's license, and those with their driver's license dream about being young adults owning their own car, and young adults dream about getting married and having a family. And the only thing that we older adults think about is how we can find a way to go back in time, knowing what we know now, and be a kid again. The kid in the movie Big found out that there are certain things in life that are made for grown-ups. In other words, there are certain things that only real grown-ups can handle and deal with. And there are some decisions that only real grown-ups can make. Let me pause parenthetically here to say, just because that you are grown don't mean you grown up. Just because you're grown don't mean that you're rent grown. And just because you're grown don't mean your light bill and water bill grown and cable bill grown and car note grown and car insurance and grocery grown. You see, when it comes to responsibility, your grown-upness is not determined by your age, but by the level of dependability to take care of your responsibilities. There are a lot of 40-year-old grown folk who have never grown up. But those who have grown up, they realize and understand that life has its ups and its downs. And you have to learn how to deal with life's down days as well as life's up days. Because in life there will be days when we will be able to tackle our temptations, but then there will be days when we will be torn by our thorn. We will be able to triumph over our troubles, but then there will be days when we will be tripped by our trials. There will be days when we can find favor over our faults, but other days we'll be frustrated by our failures. Some days we're going to win our battles of weakness, but other days we'll get worn out by worry. Some days we can run the race resiliently, other days we get run down by our reproaches. Some days we will experience peace from the Prince of Peace, but other days we're pounded by our problems. Some days helped from our hurts, but other days we're hit hard by our health. Some days we'll get grace for our guilt, and other days we'll be grounded by our greed. When we learn how to reconcile the two extremities, then we learn how to step into the realm of grown-upness. So through this epistle, we see Paul encouraging the church. But in this text, we see him dealing with his own struggle. We love saving grace, because we recognize that there is nothing within ourselves that could have caused us to save ourselves. And we thank God for saving grace. We love satisfying grace because we recognize that God looked beyond our faults and beyond our mess, and he's still merciful to bless us in spite of our mess. And we give him the highest praise for his satisfying grace. But how do you deal with God's sufficient grace? How do we reconcile the three? And I came by tonight to tell you that this grace, sufficient grace, is designed for grown-ups. It's designed for grown-ups in this text. Number one, we see the purpose of Paul's thorn. In 2 Corinthians 12:1-6, Paul tells us about an experience that he had with God, that he was caught up in the third heaven, in the realm where God dwelled. And in his testimony, he speaks of himself in the third person.
speaking of himself like that, emphasized his meekness in his vision. He realized that nothing that he did made this happen. It was something that God sovereignly chose to grant, not as a reflection of merit, because Paul thought of himself as an ordinary man. He would not boast on his own behalf as if he would merit this vision that God had given him. Paul was one who was blessed to be able to receive several visions and revelations from God. The book of Acts records 6 visions apart from the one related in this text. But the magnitude of this vision, Paul was susceptible to the constant temptation of pride. As human beings, we are all vulnerable to pride. Pride is one of the most destructive and deadliest sins, but we rarely talk about it. Think about it. Surely this would have given Paul some grounds to boast. The Lord picked him out to receive this vision. Paul must be special. He must be unique. The Lord must see something in him that he doesn't see in the other apostles. Therefore, to keep him humble, Paul was given a thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to buffet him. And here is what I like about God. I need to keep us from getting the big head. See, the reason why some folk can't get farther than they are is because we don't know how to act when we get where we're going. God knew that even Paul needed buffeting, because there is something in the human psyche that suggests, look at me. Whenever we have done something spectacular. But God tells Paul, he said, listen, Paul, I got an app for that. I got something for that. Paul's thorn in the flesh was a sort of suffering engineered by Satan. The thorn was there to cause injury. The thorn was there to bring him harm. The thorn was there to halt his ministry. The thorn was there to distract, to demolish, to demoralize, and to destroy Paul. The thorn was there to stop Paul from spreading the gospel. But tonight, somebody here needs to know that the Lord knows how to flip the script around what your enemy intended as evil and use it for your good. Satan meant it as a tool of pain, but God used it to prevent pride. The very thorn Satan is using to deceive, to distract, and to discourage you, the Lord just may be using it to prevent some worse things from happening to you. Satan thought the thorn would break me, but it blessed me. He thought it would hurt me, but it helped me. He thought it would punish me, but it protected me. He thought it would discourage me, but it delivered me. He thought it would silence me, but it stirred me. He thought it would upset me, but it untied me. He thought it would impair me, but it inspired me. He thought it would wound me, but it willed me. He thought it would slice me, but it strengthened me. He thought it would hinder me, but it humbled me. He thought it would slay me, but it saved me. He thought it would taunt me, but it taught me. He thought it would control me, but it converted me. God, in his infinite wisdom, will balance your blessings with burdens. Because burdens gives balance to our blessings, because sometimes our pride will turn our blessedness into bainness. But then we see the pain in Paul's thorn. In verse number 8, for this thing I besought the Lord thrice that it may depart from me. The question of why bad things happen to good people is an issue that troubles many people. Disease, crime, hunger, poverty, accidents, and natural disasters, even death, seem to strike without rhyme or without reason, affecting everyone. Trouble is the truest of a price, the superficial veneer of peace and happiness that we sometimes wear is stripped away, revealing what's really on the inside. And what kind of testimony that we really have. You ever see folk that come to church, and when they walk in the door, praise the Lord, everybody. God is so good, and he's good all of the time. They say that when times are good, but when they don't have money in their pocket. Hello, somebody. Y'all know what I'm talking about. The Lord balanced Paul's blessings with a burden. To impart, in part to reveal his integrity for all to see and establish his credibility. We don't know what Paul's thorn in the flesh was. The identity has been much debated. In fact, that Paul did not describe it in detail, the fact that he didn't describe it indicates that those at Corinth must have known what it was. Some have suggested that it was a physical ailment, such as migraines, ophthalmia, malaria, epilepsy, gallstones, gout, rheumatism, intestinal disorder, or even a speech impediment. But whatever the case was, a chronic, debilitating problem that was a hindrance to his ministry, and he prayed for God to remove it. Some commentators believe that Paul's thorn was someone or a group of people who constantly tormented him, discrediting his efforts and ministry to spread the gospel. But whatever it was, it hindered him from carrying out his message effectively, and it was something that tormented him to the point of seeking God to remove it three times. Word buffet is a verb that is used in the present tense, in the active voice. What it means is the thing that affected Paul was something that was continual in nature. In other words, he lived with this thing all the time. When this problem came, it came to stay. But then lastly, we see the provision for his thorn. The Lord said, "Under me, my grace is sufficient." We know that trouble don't last always, but sometimes they're up there with it and they're here to stay for a while. And sometimes you and I need to put on our big boy pants and our grown girl dress and grow up. The text says after Paul asked three times to remove this thorn, God's answer was, "My grace was sufficient." The idea of grace, the grace of God is sufficient, is the most serious issue of life that is marked by many as antiquated, simplistic, naive. They say it's like putting a Band-Aid on a broken leg. It is suggested by so-called Christian psychologists that divine grace may be sufficient for solving some problems, but deeper issues requires, but to his the total sufficiency for every need. And when you come to realize, and when you come to accept and to understand, you are for you to fulfill all of your needs. When you come to accept sufficient grace, your one bedroom apartment becomes your penthouse. When you come to accept sufficient grace, your hoopty becomes your Lexus. When you accept sufficient grace, your old clothes wear like Sean John. When you accept sufficient grace, your old shoes wear like Maslin's. When you accept sufficient grace, your old pocketbook wear like Dooney and Burke. When you accept sufficient grace, your plastic cups, your forks eat like fine china. Generic food tastes like name brand. Honey buzzers taste like honeycomb. Fruit wheels taste like Fruit Loops. Generic stuff tastes like name brand. When you accept the grace, his sufficient grace, God's grace was sufficient for Paul. The word sufficient means to be possessed of unfailing strength. It means to be enough. We must learn our sufficiency for life's situations. It comes from God. But as I read this text over and over, and I read it, it seems like 100 times, I said to myself, wait a minute. Here is Paul, who had the gift of healing, and now he himself needs to be healed. Y'all ain't hearing me tonight. Y'all. And God says to him, no. And that messed me up. God says to him, you just gotta deal with it. Because my word never changes. Brothers and sisters, as I try to close, I stop by tonight to tell you that sufficient grace, God has gotta deal with it. This grace is for grown-ups. Because this grace is not what we normally want to hear. We love favor. We love mercy. We love saving grace. We love satisfying grace. But we are not crazy about sufficient. That's because in our carnal minds, we are constantly asking ourselves, how can something so wonderful, how can something so effervescent cause me so much hurt and pain? Well, let me close and illustrate it. Story, Brother Leonard told of a husband who wanted to show his wife just how much he loved her. So he buys his wife a box freshly cut roses, all wrapped up in a nice, beautiful red bow. He gives the box to his wife, and her eyes now are beaming, and her heart is racing with excitement. She opens the box, and immediately she sees these beautiful red roses, and she smells the wonderful fragrance. She then reaches down inside of the box to grab the roses, but she grabbed them by the stem. Immediately, pain shoots up her arm. Blood begins to gush out of her hand. How could something so beautiful be so painful? She now could have said to her husband, Negro, if you really love me, you should have saved the stem. But surprisingly, she doesn't throw the rose down, neither does she become angry with her husband. But she continues to hold the rose by the stem in spite of the pain. Because she knows that the intent of the giver was not to hurt her, but the intent was to show her how much he loved her. And as I close tonight, I want to ask the question, how much do you hold God by the stem? Hold him by the stem when you criticize, ostracize, traumatize. Hold him by the stem when your loved one dies. Hold him by the stem when sickness is wrecking your body. Hold him by the stem when you get an unfavorable doctor's report. Hold him pink slip from your job. Hold him by the stem when your husband won't act right, when your wife won't love right, when your children won't do right, when your money is funny and your change is strange. Hold him by the stem when your 401k is in a state of 911A. How many can hold God by the stem? Because you know that his intent was not to hurt you, but to show you how much He loves you. Somebody came tonight and perhaps you came hurting and bleeding, holding God by the stem. But thanks be to God that you made up in your God by the stem. I want to know, are you going to hold him by the stem? Are you still going to praise God? Are you still going to give back to God? That's when you start maturing in your faith. That's when you start growing up in Christ Jesus. And I came by tonight to tell somebody, as I take my seat, it's time for us to grow up in the Church of Christ. It's time out for Similac Saints. Time out for Carnation Christians. Time out for milk drinking members. Time out for infamil elders. Time out for breast milk believers. Time out for diaper wearing deacons. Time out for playpen preachers. Time out for pouting parishioners. Time out for whining worshipers. Time out for hit and miss members. Here a Sunday, there a Sunday. It's time to grow up. I wish I had two or three people up in here that don't mind giving God a praise, because you know you've grown up. You know, and it doesn't matter. You're going to hold God by the house. You don't care. You're going to hold him by the house. If you're still going to raise you, to raise you, praise. I got peace. Praise. I can't praise you. I'm still going to praise you. If I don't get my deliverance, I'm still going to praise you. If I don't get my breakthrough, I'm still going to give the Lord some praise. I'm going to hold the Lord by the stem. It doesn't matter what happens. I'm going to hold him by the stem. I'm wondering how many can still say, my faith looks up. When you can love God, when God is allowing you to bleed, this kind of grace is not for little boys and little girls. This grace is for grown-ups. Thank you.
Oh, we ought to give him some love on that one. Grace for grown-ups. Grace for grown-ups. Hey, listen, the spirit is high. We're going to keep on going. We're going to keep on going. We're going to introduce our next speaker, Brother Jefferson from Southview Church of Christ in Magnolia, Arkansas. Brother Jefferson has been preaching for 34 years. Has a beautiful wife. Her name is Delnita. And they have three children. Now, Brother Snell done got us going. Brother Snell got us ready. Now, let's give Brother Jefferson, let's bring him up right. I don't know who's saying, who's next up? Who's next up? Brother Strong, let's bring him on up. Get up. Let's bring him up right. Get up. Get up.
Well, when trouble in my way, I gotta cry sometime. Well, yeah, when trouble in my way, yeah. I gotta cry sometime, yeah. Well, I laid awake last night, yes I did. Knowing everything is alright, yeah. Said I know that Jesus will fix it. He'll fix it after a while. Well, when trouble in my way, I shed some tears sometime. Well, when trouble in my way, oh Lord, yeah, I shed some tears sometime. Well, I went to sleep last night, yes I did, knowing everything is alright. Said I know that Jesus will fix it. Do you believe that Jesus will fix it? Well, keep on praying, yeah. The Lord said just keep on waiting, yeah. Keep on praying, yeah. Keep on waiting, yeah. He'll fix it after. to wine. Where we trouble in God's church, oh Lord. Where we ought to love all the time, yeah. Where we trouble in God's church, trouble in the body, God, and love all the time, yeah. Where I went to sleep last night, yes I did, knowing everything is alright, yeah. Said I know that Jesus will fix it. Yeah, I know that Jesus will fix it. Yes, he will. I'll just keep on praying, yeah. And I'll keep on waiting, yeah. He'll fix it after a while. After a while.
We thank God for the opportunity he has given us to congregate ourselves together. We thank God for just being God. We thank God for Jesus. We thank God for the Holy Spirit. We thank God for the committee of this 42nd lectureship, the co-host, Brother Smith and Brother Tucker, for all who have participated thus far. It's a joy to be here and be on program with such great preachers. Amen. Brother Steve and Leonard. I bring you greeting from the state of Arkansas. We have a saying in Arkansas that Arkansas is the only state in the Bible. Amen. Bible said Noah looked out to Arkansas. We bring you greeting from God's country. Amen. Amen. I don't know where to start. I got to let you come down. My goodness, I didn't need to be on this part. I tell folks all the time, and I'm honest about it, I'm just a country preacher. And to put me on stage with these guys, I tell you, Lord have mercy. For just a few minutes, I'm not going to be long. Lamentation chapter 3, verses 22 through 25. Lamentation chapter 3, verses 22 through 25. And it reads, "To the Lord mercy will not consume. Because of his compassion, because his compassion fail not. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, the soul who seek him. Because of the Lord's mercies, they will not consume. Because his compassion fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness." Subject that have been assigned to me is things that never change. Things that never change. Out of all of the hurtings, pain, suffering, fears, frustration, tears, the testing, trials, crises that all of us go through, the things that happen in life that will challenge our faith. But out of all that we go through, one thing that we can be for sure of, and that is the faithfulness of God. God is faithful, and his mercies is new every morning. The book of Lamentation provides for us, the word itself, insight on what the book is all about. Lamentation means to cry. When one is lamenting, one is filled with grief, one is filled with frustration and tears. When one is crying, there are often an expression of agony, and emotionally you can see the hurt that is in a person. The name itself, lamentation, is indicative of the fact that someone is expressing fear and pain. Jeremiah, that weeping prophet, was grief-stricken, and he is expressing his pain, his hurt over Jerusalem. Jerusalem had been destroyed. The Babylonian had came in and captured that city. Jerusalem had been ruined. And the reason why God allowed the Babylonian to come in and capture the Jews was because of sin. Sin is a very terrible thing. And the record says that the wages of sin is death. Sin carries with it penalty. And one thing that would never change is sin would never change. Because all sin is in one of three categories. It's the lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, or the pride of life. And all sin will be punished. Sin will either be pardoned in Christ or punished by God. Sin is a very terrible thing, and it is because of sin that the children of Israel was in captivity. For Jeremiah, it was a dark day. It was a dreary day. Jeremiah cried over his people. The psalmist captured the words or the mindset of the children of Israel when he said in Psalm 137, he said, "By the river of Babylon, there we sat down, and we wept when we remember Zion. We hang our harp upon the widows in the midst thereof. And for they said to us, sing unto us a Zion song." They said, "How can we sing a Zion song in a strange land?" The city of Jerusalem had been ruined. It was left in ruin and rubbish. The holy place was now a holy ash pile. The women there had become widows, and the children fatherless. The aged men was left to die, and the men who were sick was left to starve. The young men and young women was carried off into captivity to become slaves in Babylon. The king's family was killed in front of his eyesight, and then his eyes was gouged out. And they put him in prison until the day he died. The walls of Jerusalem had been torn down. The gates had been torn from his hinges. The city treasury now was in the hands of ungodly men. The holy vessels of Jerusalem had been taken now to be used by unholy men. The city was left in desolation, and Jeremiah cried. He wept over Israel. Someone has suggested that crying and weeping is a universal language. Weeping is something that we all can understand and do. I've seen people from China cry. And when they cry, they don't cry in Chinese. They just cry. I've seen people from Egypt cry. And when they cry, they doesn't cry in Arabic. They just cry. I've seen people from France cry. And when they cry, they don't cry in French. They just cry. I've seen people from Greece cry. They don't cry in Greek. They just cry. I've seen the Italian cry. They just cry. I have a member that go to the church where I labor. She is a Korean, and she have come to my office and cried about her grandson, but she did not cry in Korean, she just cried. I've been to the hood and I've seen little babies cry. They didn't cry in Ebonic, they just cried. Crying is a universal language. And Jeremiah cried over the condition of his people. But in the midst of a hopeless situation,
in the midst of a dark situation, Jeremiah seemed to find some light. In the midst of pain, seemed as if he found joy. In the midst of destruction, it seemed as if he found divine destiny. Jeremiah cried. But Jeremiah began to say, it is because of the Lord's mercies that we're not consumed. He said, we ought to be dead. We should be dead because of our sin, because of what we've done. We ought to be dead. But because of God's mercy, he have allowed us to go into captivity. But yet, he is keeping us alive. Is there anybody here today? I feel a little better now. Is there anybody here who knows that we ought to be dead? We should be dead. Ought to be in our grave. But because of God's mercy, he keeping us alive. He allow us to suffer. He punish us for our sin. But yet he keeps us alive. Sin have that is carried with it crops. And the seeds of sin that we plant, we have to reap the crop from those sins. And though God will forgive us, and though God will give us a new opportunity, we still have to reap what we sow. God will save you. He'll save you, give you a home in heaven. But you still have to reap what you sow. You still got to pay child support. Still have to pay alimony. Yeah, you still, if you do the time, do the crime, have to do the time. In other words, there are crops that we have to reap. A whole lot of time, folks, you hear folks say, I'm bearing the cross. I don't know why God putting so much on me. I'm bearing my cross. Those are not crosses that you burn. Those are crops that you're reaping. And so the children of Israel was reaping crops from their own doing. And so Jeremiah cried. Jeremiah said, it is because of God's faithfulness. It is because of God's mercy that we are not consumed. Let me give you three things about God's faithfulness, his mercy that never changed. And that is, the first thing I want to deal with is the fullness of his faithfulness. And then the forcedness of his faithfulness. And then finally, the freshness of his faithfulness. The fullness of God's faithfulness. God's faithfulness is always in his fullness. God never half do anything. God will always be God and always do everything just right. God is a faithful God. And when Jeremiah talk about God's mercy, it is in a plural form. It said the mercies of God. Jeremiah proclaimed that the mercies are plural. The psalmist writer said in Psalm 51, he said, Lord, have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according to the multitude of thy tender mercy. Blot out my transgression. I stop by to tell you, God's divine blessings is always in the fullness form. God doesn't just bless us in one way, but God blesses us in many ways. God's form of blessing is not just in one design, but it's in many designs. You see, he's my shepherd, but at the same time, he's my father. He's my father, but at the same time, he's a hiding place. He's a hiding place, but at the same time, he's a rock. He's the light. He's a strength. He's everything I need. That's why Paul said in Ephesians 3:20, he said, now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think. Now, exceedingly would have been enough, but he said abundantly above all that we ask our thing. In other words, God does it, and he does it in the fullness. That's what I like about my God. He don't halfway do nothing. You remember the children of Israel when they was in the wilderness for 40 years? Moses said in Deuteronomy 29, he wrote, God says, I led you for 40 years in the wilderness. And for 40 years, your clothes didn't get old. Your shoes didn't wear out. For 40 years, you was maintained and you had everything that you needed. That's what I like about God. We complain about what we don't have. We whine and cry about what we want. We don't have this, we don't have that, but yet we get larger. We steady getting larger. I stop by to tell you, God, give us everything that we need. By your mercies, we are not consumed. We ought to be dead. Should be dead. But God's mercies kept us alive. But behind God's mercy was a forcedness. In other words, the Babylonian was a force to be reckoned with. They was a powerful organization. They was a powerful group, warriors. But even though they had power, God had more power. You see, God is a heart fixer and a mind regulator. And God allowed them to come in and take them captive. But at the same time, he kept them alive. He said, by God's mercies, we're not consumed. In other words, God is all powerful. I hear the water power. I hear the steam power, AC power, DC power, horsepower. But there's another power to call all power. That's the power that God have. God have all power. And God's power supersedes fire power. Because God can tell fire not to burn. God's power supersedes water power. Because God can tell water to stand up like a wall so his children can cross over on dry land. God have all power. He can tell the sun to stand still. He controls time in his hand. Thanks be to God that I serve a God with all power. But not only that, but lastly, I got to leave you. His mercies, it says, is fresh. It's new every morning. That's a shouting point right there. God blessing, God mercy is never stale. God doesn't give us leftovers. God doesn't give us that is stale. But God give us new mercies. God give us new mercies every morning. You remember the children of Israel when they wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. They said, we're hungry. God said, don't worry about it. I'm going to feed you manna from heaven. And every day, walk out and get what you need. But don't get enough and try to save it. Because every day I'm going to feed you manna from heaven. Because I want my blessings to be fresh. Yes, you remember Elijah down by the brook. God sent two ravens twice a day. One was a butcher and one was a baker. Because one brought him meat and the other one brought him bread. They fed Elijah down by the brook twice a day. You remember the Lord's Prayer? He said, give us this day our daily bread. Yes, God's mercies is new every morning. Every morning when you get up, God give you new blessing. You know, every morning when you get up, it's a new day. And what I like about those old brethren down in the country, they used to pray prayers, and you could almost see it with your mind. They would say prayers like, thank you, Lord, for waking us up this morning. And those old deacons would say things like, thank you, Lord, that the four corners of our bedroom wasn't the four corners of our grave. Thank you that our beds wasn't our cooling board. And then they said, thank you, Lord, for waking us up this morning and open eyes to see a new day, a day that I never saw before. In other words, every day was a new day. I saw a whole lot of Mondays. These 50 years that I live, I've seen some 2,600 and some Monday. But when I got up this morning was a new Monday. The air that I breathe was new air. And the sun ray was a new ray. The food that I ate was new food. And the things that I began to do was done in a new day. Thank you, Lord, for a new day. Yeah, God's mercy is new every day. New deliverance for our trial. New termination for your situation. New grace for your struggle. New glory for your story. New possibilities for your impossibility. New opportunity for what you're going through. God doesn't give me leftover, but God gives me mercy that is new every day. You see, and so the writer said, God been good to us. Notice what he said. He says, in verse number 25, the Lord is good to those who wait on him. And I'll stop by to tell you as I close on my way to heaven that God's mercy is new every morning. And every morning when you get up, you ought to say, thank you, Lord. Thank you for blessing me to see another day. I thank you for blessing me to see a day that wasn't promised. And so as I leave you today, I want to tell you God been good to us, brought us from a mighty long ways, brought us through ups and downs, through many dangers, toss and snare. And so as I praise God and give God glory down in the country, every now and then I get a little happy. Every now and then I wave my hand. Every now and then I get to thinking about the goodness of God. I wave my hand and say, thank you, Jesus. For what I have, he gave it to me. What I know, he taught it to me. What I am, he made it. All my blessings come from God. That's why I don't worry about no praise policeman. Amen. Because God been too good to me. As a matter of fact, if you wonder why I praise him, and if you wonder how I praise him like I do, let me give you right quickly 10 top reasons why I praise him. I praise him, number one, because he's been good to me. He put food on my table, clothes on my back, roof over my head. Clothed me in my right mind, gave me eyes to see, legs to walk, gave me a little money to spend. I praise him because he's been good to me. Number two is he's been good to me. Number three is he's been good to me. Number four is he's been good to me. Number five, he's been good to me. Number six is he's been good to me. Number seven, some of you still ain't got it. He's been good to me. Number eight, he's been good to me. Number nine, he's been good to me. Number 10, he's been good to me. God is still good. I praise him. If he don't do nothing else for me, he's already.
Oh, let's give Brother Jefferson a hand for that. Things that never change. Things that never change. All right, all right. Now, I've heard there's a group from Orlando. I heard there was a powerful group from Orlando that's going to come at this time.
Now we got revelation. Let's bring revelation in. Let's bring revelation up. Now y'all gonna give them a hand while they come on in. Here come revelation. Three.
Check. Revelation couldn't make it tonight, so I saw a lot of singers in the building, and I said, help me bring my preacher up. Is that all right?
Watch it.
So, and you lead the way, Lord. I praise you and I thank you for another day. Hey. Oh, Lord, I praise you, Lord Jesus. Oh, Lord, I praise you right now. Ooh, I praise you, Lord Jesus. Hey.
I'm
need you right now.
Show me the way. Oh,
show me the way. Down here, and I knew your power.
He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, we see how great, how great is our God. Said the splendor of the King, robed in majesty, robed in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great, yes, is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, we see how great is our God. How great is he, how great, yes, is our sing.
God, say amen tonight. If you judge him by his height, you'll find there's none his size. If you put him in a grave, he'll surely rise. He can walk on the water and not get wet. He can go through a fire and won't even sweat. He's a great God. He's the God that fed the thousands who did not have bread. He brought people back from the dead, drove out demons from the demon bound, and taught us how to walk on holy ground. Made the leper's skin like new. Storms dissipated when he told it to. Took jars of water, turned it into wine, even saved this soul of mine. He's a great God. If your God ain't working, you ought to try my God tonight. He's a great God. Now, if he ain't never done nothing for you, I don't blame you. I wouldn't say nothing either. But if by chance, if God has done anything for you, if you know it was him that woke you up this morning, if it was him that started you on your another way, he didn't have to do it. But I'm so glad that he did. He's a great God. Some of us think we have great problems, but my God is greater than my problems. Oh yeah, I got problems. Sometimes my problems got problems and my situations got situations, but my God is greater. Trouble in my way, I don't know about y'all, but sometimes I gotta cry sometimes. I lay awake at night, but that's all right. Somebody say Jesus will fix it. And he'll fix it after a while. If you don't fix it today, he'll fix it tomorrow. If you don't fix it tomorrow, he'll fix it next week. If you don't fix it next week, he'll fix it next month. If you don't fix it next month, he'll fix it next year. If you don't fix it next year, I go into after a while mode. Anybody in here like me in after a while mode? He don't always come when you want him to come. But he'll fix it after a while. I'm thankful. I'm glad. I'm humble to have been invited to be a participant in this all-star lineup tonight. Michael Jordan and Muhammad Ali. Michael Jordan, Muhammad Ali, and put a little me. If it was not for so many people who come from Orlando to hear me preach, I wouldn't preach tonight. I feel like the story of the woman who got up Sunday morning with her husband. She was getting ready for church service, and she was giddy and happy and preparing herself, putting the clothes on, and he laying there, hadn't moved a finger. And she looked at him and said, "Honey, get up, time to get dressed." And he didn't move. He said, "I'm not going today." She said, "You're not going to church today?" He said, "I'm not going today." She said, "Why are you not going?" He said, "Well, I got three reasons I'm not going." He said, "Congregation is cold. Nobody likes me. And I'm not going." And his wife looked at him and said, "Well, I got three reasons you ought to go. The congregation is warm. Some people like you. And you the pastor." So if I wasn't a pastor tonight, I wouldn't even come up here tonight. I'm just thankful. What a magnanimous job. Give these two preachers a hand tonight. There ain't nothing I can do. I can't fail tonight. Amen. There's been some preaching done up in here. I want to appreciatively applaud Brother Joe Tucker, Brother Robert Smith, Brother Sapp, and all the lectureship committee who have been the architectural designers and the executors of such a fine and efficacious lectureship. Because of the expiation of my sins and the propitiation of Christ, I am just thankful to have been invited by these brethren to allow me to stand for a few fleeting, phonetic moments on tonight. I do have in the audience several people who are near and dear to me. One of our bishops, one of our elders, one of our presbyters, Brother Willie Davis, has come to support his preacher from Orlando. Stand up, Bishop. He's a good man. One of the men that worked with me at the Southside Church. I know there's some other Southside. They said that was Revelation tonight singing. That was Revelation. I must have been gone too long. I mean, they sure sound good, but I didn't know some of them people, and all the members of Revelation go where I preach, and I was thankful to have them serve. All the people from the Southside Church, would you stand? Those who come to support their preaching tonight, I would appreciate. All my members have come. Yes, no, I ain't talking about. And then tonight, there's a special guest for me, Sister Linda Adams. Many of you know her, and her great husband. who was the visionary architect of our congregation, Dr. Jerome Adams. God called him home to glory. And I want to always be mindful to recognize her in his absence. He introduced me to the Southeastern Lectureship in 1998. I am eternally grateful. I have not missed one since. And when he was a physician in Orlando, he closed his office the week of the Southeastern. And he and his beautiful wife would come with me to hear me preach at the Southeastern. And she's here tonight. I want her to stand and be recognized. Please show Sister Adams some love. And then there's a beautiful black Nubian queen in the house. There's a woman who is the apple of my eye and wind beneath my wings. And we've just celebrated 35 consecutive years. Back home, Church Knoll, in my phone, I don't even dial her number. I got it on voice dial. I just put the phone up and say, Brick House. Amen. Amen. I just say, Brick House. And in her phone, she just voice dial me. She says, Hercules. Amen. Amen. Don't hate. Don't hate. Don't hate. Congratulate. God may let you participate. Amen. Amen. So I'm Hercules. I'm Mufasa. Amen. Amen. So if you would be so beneficently kind, beloved tonight, allow me to summon your senses and invite your spiritual intellect to the book of Philippians, chapter 3, a very familiar passage to those who've had any tenure in the body of Christ. I want to read commensurate with the 13th verse, Philippians chapter 3, verse number 13. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do. I'm forgetting those things which are behind me. Lord, wouldn't congregations stop splitting? Wouldn't marriage divorce be an all-time low if people would just learn to forget the stuff that behind us? And then he didn't just say leave it there. He said, after I forget what's in my back, rearview mirror, he says, then I reach forth unto the things which are before me. And subsequently, I press, I struggle toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God, which is only found in Christ Jesus. In Paul's instructions to the church of Philippi, is to forget the things that are behind, struggle for the things which are before. Tonight, I want to talk about living in the moment. Living in the right now. Beloved, the great apostolos of old, the former Saul of Tarsus, this prolific, powerful, palliative, prognosticating personality of the New Testament. Now he is seasoned. He is sage. He has venerable wisdom. This book of Philippi, I believe, ranks amongst his greatest valedictories of the New Testament. This man, as you know, comes with impeccable credentials. He has diversity in his dialogue. Paul was able to speak to the philosophical Greeks as they sat around the Parthenons in Athens. Paul was able to speak to the monarchs of Egypt with her pharaohs sitting around the Sphinx in Cairo. He was able to talk to the rulers of Rome, her Neros and her Caesars, as they ruled the known world. Yet he could condescend himself and speak to the vagabond Jews there in Jerusalem. He writes this epistolary
from Nero's dark and dingy dungeon in Rome. Paul is on lockdown. Paul is incarcerated. Paul has the chains and manacles around his hands and his feet. Not only is he in prison, but he's suffering some sort of malady, some physical malady and some spiritual obstructions. Scholars have debated what's wrong with Paul. Some thought it was his glaucoma or his cataracts. His optic nerve did not function to full capacity. But in the midst of his calamitous experiences, in the midst of his trials and tribulations, in the midst of his storms and strident people he dealt with as an apostle, Paul said, I learned one thing. And sometime in life, you can't hold on to but one thing at a time. We're trying to be rulers over many when we hadn't mastered a few yet. Paul said, there's one thing I do. I've learned how to forget the stuff in my rear view mirror. And while I'm forgetting that, I'm going forward toward the prize of the high mark of God in Christ Jesus. Paul said, I can't do nothing about yesterday. I cannot control tomorrow. So what I ought to do and what you ought to do, what all of us ought to do, is live right now. You see, Paul knew something about trouble. Anybody in here besides me and Paul know anything about trouble? See, trouble, you don't have to pledge the fraternity of trouble. You don't have to cross the burning sands into the sorrow of the sisterhood of trouble. You don't have to, trouble knows your unlisted phone number. You don't have to sign up for trouble at trouble.com. You don't have to, beloved, go to the QVC shopping channel to find trouble. Trouble will come to your house and ring your doorbell. No, it don't even ring the doorbell. It'll just knock the door in. I came by to tell you tonight, keep on living. Keep on saying good morning. You may be riding high right now. You may be drinking out of your saucer because your cup doesn't overflow. But everybody in here, well, sooner or later, we'll have to sign up for trouble.com. Well, beloved, Paul said, I know something about trouble. But he warns us against the danger of what happens when we dwell on the past or we have fears of our future. That's why it's incumbent, imperative of all of us to live in the moment. Yesterday is history. Tomorrow is a mystery. All we have is right now. Yesterday is a canceled check. Tomorrow is a promissory note. But today we got cash money. You better learn to live in the right now. Paul, as you know, had deep affection and love for the saints at Philippi. At the genesis of this congregation in Acts chapter 16, you remember Paul and Silas started a jail ministry there in the Philippian jail. But the Bible says, along about midnight, every church ought to have some midnight madness every now and then. You ought to have some prison praise. It's all right to even have some joy in jail. And if Paul and Silas could have some joy in jail, why is it the Church of Christ afraid to have some joy in church? I came by to tell you tonight, beloved, if they could have praise in prison, we ought to sure enough have some praise in the pew. I came by to tell you in these short four books, from the salutation all the way to the doxology, Paul had some very poignant points he left in the archives of the scripture. Paul, remember, said, I prayed that I might know him and the power of his resurrection. You remember he said, my God shall supply all my needs according to his riches in glory. And who will forget what he said in Philippians 4:13? I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. But I believe what he said here about forgetting my past. If you don't bury your past will bury you. I came by to tell you, you cannot live in the past. Even though we've gotten up, where most of us in here are full age and we enjoying grown folk grace,
You will never get grace for what you're doing right now if you keep dwelling on what you've done in the past. Some people will not allow you to forget your past. They always bring up what you used to do, what you used to be, where you used to go, how you used to dance, how you used to drink. They always bring up what you used to do. I'm so glad that the God I serve takes a divine eraser and gets and eradicates my past so I can enjoy my present and I can look forward to my future. Well, tonight, beloved, if you focus on yesterday, if yesterday dominates your life, and if you are too intrigued by tomorrow, you miss the blessings of today. I said, Paul said, leave your past behind. He didn't say forget your past. It's hard to really forget. That the verbiage, the lexicon, the etymology there is saying leave it in the past. I know you can't forget what happened to you. I know if somebody slapped you on the right cheek, you might be like me. I have a problem with that turn the other cheek. Amen. I'm still under construction. Say amen. Don't try me. Amen. When you can't. Amen. Amen. I'm working on it. I'm working on it, but I ain't there yet. Anybody besides me still under construction? Now you super saints, I ain't talking to you. All y'all to have coffee with God every morning and he check with you before he do anything. Go on with your bad self. I'm talking about people in here who are like me. I'm trying to get it right. I'm working on getting it right. I'm praying about getting it right, but little don't always get it right. And don't you catch me on the wrong day. Tell the truth and stay in the church. You will never make sufficient progress to your future destiny if you focus too much on the past. Listen, folks, glance back, but look forward. It's all right every now and then to take a nostalgic stroll down memory lane. And if you're like me, sometimes when I glance back and take a panoramic view of my life, there's some things I wish I hadn't done. If I could do it over, anybody in here over 50 like me? You remember Tyrone Davis said, if I could turn. Oh, I see y'all ain't been baptized all your life. For you young jitterbugs in here, Tyrone Davis, this back when music was music. This back when the music, the words meant something. This back when they sang with the clothes on. Say amen when you can. This back foot, it was gyrating, and I wish I had a church in here. Tyrone Davis said, if I could turn back, and everybody in here has got that testimony, there's some component, some area of your life you wish you could go back. But that is not possible. You cannot go back. You cannot go forward. All you can do is live right now. God is the only one who can supersede time. God can go back and go forward and be here right now. God is the creator of time. God is so awesome that he was somewhere before somewhere became somewhere. Before there was a then and a there. Before there was a when and a where. Before there was a why and a wherefore, there was God. He created everything from nothing. He sees afters and befores. He reached up one day and grabbed the microphone of time. And God said, let there be. And then love, let fell in love with be. And everything that was not starts straining to become. Psalms 91 and 2 said, the Lord, you are our dwelling place in all generations. You are from everlasting to everlasting. Thou art God. God is the only one who's Alpha and Omega. He's the first and the last. He's the beginning and the end. He's the author and the finisher. I came to tell you, God is the bookends that enclose time. God is in front of time. God is behind time. God does not exist in time. That's why God is never late. How you gonna tell God he's taking too long when he ain't governed by time? God is no no such thing as fashionably late with God. God existed before the tick-tock began the clock. So God can never be late. He's sooner than at once. He's quicker than right now. He keeps bumping into himself everywhere he goes. You need to know about the awareness of the everywhereness of God, the universality of God. God is already where he's going, and he's still where he is when he gets where he's going. He doesn't have to leave where he's going to get where he is. He can be tiptoed and stand flat-footed at the same time. He can strike a straight lick with a straight stick. I came by to tell you, ain't nobody like God. God can send a hurricane and a tornado and tear up St. Petersburg and do millions of dollars worth of damage, and nobody can charge him with destruction of property. God can send a lightning storm and set this city on fire, and nobody can arrest him for arson. God can unleash the wind in a hurricane and blow faster and harder than a supersonic jet, and no highway patrolman can write him a ticket for going too fast. When we do wrong, God can whip us as long as he want, hard as he want, and nobody at DCF can bring God up for child abuse. God can give us what we want sometime and not give us what we think we need, but no judge can call him and summon him to the court and charge God with parental delinquency. Can't nobody go back, can't nobody go forward, and can't nobody be right now, right here at the same time but God. And since we can't do that, let us live right now. Too many of us are halted, hunted, hindered, and hurt by our past. We got to learn to live in the moment. You can plan for the future. You can dream about the future. You can fantasize about the future. But you better live in the moment. Some of you sisters missing some good man because you're hunted by your past. You date Scrap Iron and Willie Bobo, Little Pistol Starter. He broke your heart, and now every man you see, you got a litany of questions from here to Jacksonville and back because you're haunted by your past. Now you think all men are dogs because you have been called Sister Kibbles and Bit. I wish I had a church in here tonight. No, don't let your past destroy your present and hinder you from your future. Some of y'all ain't got no better sense, but keep asking, what's his sign? What's his sign? Come here, child. If he won't work, that's a sign. Say amen when you can. He already cussed his mama out, cussed his sister out, called women female dogs in garden too. Girl, that's a sign. He won't work in a pie factory tasting pie. That's a sign. He got a pocket full of money, ain't got no job, his eyes always bloodshot. That's a sign. The rims on his car cost more than the car cost. That's a sign. You don't need to consult the horoscope. You need to consult the Holy Spirit. He needs to be, the sign he ought to be under is the sign of the cross. See, if he'd been born again, even what happened in his past is in the past. See, yeah, that's our problem. We preach a lot of stuff we don't believe. Old things passed away. Behold, all things. Say amen. Yeah, I was at the doctor's the other day, went to a new doctor. Doctor asked me, they made me fill out all that paperwork now. And they asked me, said, you forgot to put on when you were born. I looked at it, I said, the first time or the second time? Say amen if you can. Because see, I've been born again. That's the problem with this homosexual thing we're grappling with right now. I got people in Orlando and they educated and scientific and they've matriculated from prestigious universities, and they telling me, Brother Leonard, they just born that way. And I agree, no, they were born that way. That's why you gotta be born again. However you were born, you got to be born again. All of us, though, lest I be too long, we all have the propensity and the proclivity to
reminisce on the good old days. If you're not careful, you'll live life in your rearview mirror. Freeman White said some years ago, I remember, if God wanted you looking back, he wouldn't have put both of your eyes in the front of your head. He'd have put one eye here and put one eye there. But since he put them both in the front, he wants you going forward. I wish I had a church in here. It's all right to remember. Memory is a great thing. God gave Homo sapiens memory. We can remember good times. We can remember lost loved ones. It's all right to remember. But don't ever try to put the gear of life in reverse and go back. Because you cannot go back in time, and you cannot speed up time. So learn to live in the moment. Romans 15 and 4, you remember, Paul said, what's written aforetime is not written for our living, but for our learning. If you don't conquer the demons of your past, if you don't learn that whoever hurt you, the people that hurt you and you mad about it, you still sulking about it, you wearing out your carpet, walking the floor all night long, and the people you mad at that forgot all about it, they somewhere asleep while you taking medicine, running your blood pressure up. Say amen when you can. You got to learn how to build a bridge and get over it. There's some stuff you got to let go. You ain't got no better sense going to Jerry Springer show and calling somebody who hurt your feelings in the seventh grade when they call you ugly. Yeah, all of us was ugly in the seventh grade. Go back and look in your photo album. All of us was ugly. Say amen if you can. Some people that you mad at, see, some of the people who've done me the most harm were the people who gave me the impetus to go forward. See, some of the people you talking about, you ought to get them and write them a letter and thank them for keeping you on your knees. Thank them for keeping you reading your Bible. Thank them for keeping you coming to Sunday school and church. Instead of you talking about them, write them a thank you letter. If it wasn't for you and your crazy behind, I wouldn't be as saved as I am right now. See, you got to always remember this. Anybody that stabs you in the back, anybody that talks behind your back, remember, if they stab you in the back, that means you're still in front of them. Say amen when you can. You're still in front of them. You got to learn in life how to take your stumbling blocks and turn them into stepping stones. Turn your pain in the game, your pain in the power. The scars of life comes from the scars of love. I came by to tell you, not only you can't control your past, Brother Snell, you really can't control your future. James said in James 4, take no thought for tomorrow, for tomorrow will take care of the things of itself. You see, some of you now sitting around waiting on Social Security, it may not be there, because Social Security was predicated on two things. When Roosevelt instituted it, he counted on people dying by the time they were 70 years old. And the other part was that the young people would work to pay you until you die. The problem with Social Security is people living longer and young people won't work. Don't you put your faith in a government check. Say amen when you can. You better learn how to live right now. Live in the moment. Let God cover your past. Let Jesus control your future. And all you, that's why Jesus said, give us this day our daily bread. You don't have to worry about, listen, I don't know about y'all. Today is September 28th. I got enough money to live the rest of my life if I don't live past the end of this month. Preach, Brother Little. Too many of us are dominated by our past. Too many of us are controlled by the things that are behind us. Listen, folks,
Sister, I don't care if he broke your heart. I don't care what he did to you. Don't let what you've done in the past define the rest of your life. We all have made mistakes. Maybe you did have a pregnancy out of wedlock, but that ought not to define you the rest of your life. Maybe you did have a failed marriage, but that ought not to control your destiny. Maybe you didn't finish school when you should have finished school. Maybe you got to do like some of us are doing, going back to school in our later years. But folks, I came by to tell you what happened in the past does not have to control your future. Yeah, maybe you did get tied up with a no good. Even if he messed with your head, don't let him control your heart. Girl, go get your hair done, your nails done, your feet done. Go by that place where Victoria keeps her secret. And go home and look at yourself in the mirror. And if ain't no man around, say, I still look good. That's what God did in Genesis. God took 7 days and made everything. And since there wasn't nobody there to praise him, God looked around and said, it's good. So sometimes when there ain't nobody there to make you feel good about yourself, you got to tell yourself, it's all good. You cannot fix yesterday. I'm almost done. You can't fix your past. See, some of us are so consumed, but some of us who are African-American in descent, we still mad about slavery. You think you got off the boat. You think your name Kunta Kinte. You so mad about stuff. You ain't even gone through segregation. You don't even know what it's like to drink out of a separate water fountain or to sit in a different part of the restaurant or to sit in the balcony. I've never seen so many mad young people who ain't been through nothing, who think they're entitled to everything. At some point, folks, you got to remember it and learn from it, but you got to let it go. Because the folk you mad at, they ain't losing no. Say amen when you can. The Bible says, even when you mess up, Paul said in Ephesians 4:28, let him that stole, he didn't even say take back what you stole. He said, when you find out stealing's wrong, quit stealing. I had a fella in Tallahassee, a true story. One fella in Tallahassee, he was a known womanizer, known player from the Himalaya, Splackavalian in Tallahassee. He came to the Spring Hill Road Church where I was preaching. We taught him one Saturday. He obeyed the gospel. We baptized him. He got out the water. He said, Brother Leonard, say, I feel so good. I'm going to go find all the women and their husbands, and I'm going to repent. I said, no. No. We baptize you this Saturday, we'll bury you next Saturday. The Bible didn't say go back and straighten all that out. When you find out it's wrong, just quit. See, some of y'all, listen, if you got a hot TV in your house, don't take it back. Say it really, you can. Take it back, the popo go get you. When you find out it's wrong, just quit. I'm done. Jesus told that woman in John 8 when she was caught in adultery. Y'all read the Bible, didn't you? You know what the Levitical law said. They caught her. They didn't see this on Facebook. They caught her, which means they were as wrong as she was. That means they had to go tiptoeing looking through a window. That's how some Church of Christ folk are. They're looking to catch you. Same. And Jesus said to her, go. See, when you mess up, you can't go back. He said, woman, go forward. But while you're going forward, just remember this. Don't sin no more. Well, let me sneak to my seat. Let me tell you something. If you don't learn to live in the moment, if you don't learn to appreciate the right now, if you're a person that's focused either on your past are so concerned or worried about your future, you cannot see and appreciate the blessings of right now. God is a good God, not yesterday. I don't know what he's going to do tomorrow, but anybody here besides me know that he's a God that's good right now? Anybody got some right now praise? Anybody got some right now joy? Anybody got some right now hallelujah? Anybody got some right now thank you, Jesus? I remember, as I go to my seat, I was watching TV the other day, and Brother Andy, I saw a commercial, an infomercial, and the infomercial, I love how they trying to pitch their products, and they tell you what the product is, and they tell you how much it costs, and they tell you the benefits of ordering, and they prey on the ignorance of the consumer. And they'll say stuff like, if you order in the next 10 minutes, you'll get this reduction price. And your crazy self don't know they run that every hour. Say amen when you can. They think they make you a deal you can't refuse. And then sometimes they'll say stuff like, and if you order in the next 10 minutes, you can get two for the price of one. And then they sweeten the deal even further. They say stuff like, and if you order in the next 10 minutes, the postage and delivery will be paid. But my favorite part of the infomercial is when sometimes the announcer says stuff like, after all he's explained, after all the perks he's offered, he'll say, but wait, there's more. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying? See, sometimes when we're reminiscing and having fun and appreciating God, I can hear God saying to us, I know I've been a good God, but wait, there's more. God said, I got the slaves out of Egypt, but wait, there's more. God said, when they was at the Red Sea, I told Moses to stretch out his rod and H2O separated from each other, and they walked across on dry ground. But wait, lectureship, there's more. When they got hungry, God rained manna from above. When they got thirsty, God said, I gave you water out of a rock. But God said, but wait, there's more. God said, your shoes and your clothes lasted 40 years. But wait, there's more. God said, when you got to Jericho, you marched around 7 times on 7 days, and the walls came tumbling down. But wait, there's more. God said, I've been a shelter in your time of storm. I dried your weeping eyes. I opened doors no man can open. I closed doors no man can close. I've been your company keeper in your lonely hour. But wait, there's some more. God says, you're so blessed that you go to your closet, you got to stand there 10 minutes to decide what to put on. You're such and so blessed, you got so many shoes that you wear one pair, got another pair in your hand, put on that pair at church, and then change when you go home. But wait, there's more. You lost your job, but you didn't lose your house. You lost your health, but you didn't lose your life. You lost your spouse, but you didn't lose your mind. You lost your money, but you didn't lose your church membership. God's our protector, our provider, our power, our provision. But wait, there's more. He sent a man named Jesus, died on the cross, but wait, there's some more. He got up early Sunday morning, went back to glory, making intercession for us, but there's more. He's coming back again to save us from our sin, and you and I ought to forget the past, don't worry about the future. Thank God for right now. Thank God for right now. Listen. You need to come to Jesus. Not based on your past. We all got a past. Not based on your future, because you don't know what that holds. Say amen when you can. What you need to do is respond to the invitation based on what's going on right now. I've learned, Brother Snell, Brother Jefferson, man, listen, I was in preaching in Houston, Texas. My only son lives in Houston. He goes to the Belfort Road Church there. And I've learned, listen, I've learned, God blesses us when we got enough sense to know how to treat each other right. Even if you did make me mad, even if I've been hurt, I've been hurt by church people. And to be honest with you, I ain't never had a Baptist preacher say nothing about me. All my troubles ain't coming from the Methodists and the Episcopalians. The Pope ain't never done nothing to me. All the injuries spiritually I got is from my brethren. Say amen when you can. But I've learned that there's some stuff folk did to you, you just got to let it go. Well, he ain't never apologized. Some people ain't going to never say they sorry. They ain't got that much sense. If they don't say they sorry, still let it go. Do you not know God can handle some stuff better than you can? Matter of fact, God can handle everything better than you can. Can't nobody get an enemy like God can get them. Listen, I was in Houston. This is my mantra now. I'm gonna be nice to y'all. The people where I preach know, y'all don't know this because y'all just see me at the lectureship. They know I can sometimes be colored. Amen. I'm trying to say this and stay in the church. I was in Houston, and I was getting ready to preach one night at Belfort Road. I was watching the news, the local news, and there's a pro football team in Houston called the Houston Texans. They got the best defensive player in the league. His name is J.J. Watt. Those of you who know football, J.J. Watt was the MVP of the National Football League last year. Not the defensive player of the year. He was the most valuable player in the league. Bad boy, 20-something sacks, ferocious. Scored 3 touchdowns, intercepted from defensive end, intercepted 4 or 5 passes. In Houston, while I was there, they had a day after practice that all the boys or girls who were under 15, under 18, whatever the number was, could come to the facility, wait in line, and J.J. Watt, this perennial all-pro, would sign an autographed football and give it to them. Now, maybe that don't make you shocked because you don't know if you get a signed autograph by the MVP. One day you could sell it on eBay. It's valuable. News reported this because one little old boy, little Caucasian boy, got in line, stayed 2 hours waiting to get an autograph after practice. God will bless you. I wish I had a church in here. And I don't know about y'all. I forgot what people done to me in the past. I don't know what's going to happen to me in the future. But I do know when you're nice to people, God will bless you. And you can't beat God's blessing. Come to Jesus right now. If you're guilty distance, come. If there's one or more who don't know him in the pardon of your sins, come. There's one or more who need baptism. You know our mantra. You know our modus operandi. You know our standard operational procedure. You need to hear the gospel, believe it with all of your heart, repent of your sins, verbalize, audibilize your faith and confidence that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. Join him in baptism, immerse in water, further remission, removal, eradication of your sin. That process adds you to his body, the church, and you ought to be nice to people because then God will bless you. Don't dwell on your past. Don't focus on your future. Appreciate God right now. If that's applicable to your life, come. If you need prayer, come. If you need to repent of sins, whatever your dilemma, whatever your scenario, whatever your situation, I beg, I plead, I admonish you to come while we stand and while we sing.
So, oh, Lord, I want you to help me singing, oh, Lord. I want you to help me. Want you to help me.
Thank you so much for staying with us here on OCTN.TV. We've heard some wonderful, wonderful message on this evening. Starting again this afternoon at 2 o'clock with my guest here on this evening. We've heard some fantastic lessons. The church is on fire. The crowd is good. And certainly we are grateful to God for the blessings that he's pouring out on us in this lectureship. And we hope that you at home, who are watching, wherever you are, and you're watching on your device, whether it be your computer, your telephone, whatever it is, we just want to share this blessing. And we're happy that you have a chance to tune in to OCTN and watch. We have a guest with us on this evening. He is none other than Brother Orlando Thomas from the Liberty City Church of Christ in Miami, Florida. We want to welcome him to our set this evening. Brother Orlando, thank you so much for joining OCTN. Oh, yeah. just give me a quick review of Orlando Thomas, and where you're from, you know, what your ministry is like, before we talk about what we went on here today.
There in Miami. I've been there now for the past 4.5 years. My family and I, we've had certainly an awesome time helping and developing in the church as we just really just kind of senior leadership to gain particular things that's preparing me towards seeing. So it's an awesome experience. I'm thankful to be here and to have this opportunity as well.
All right, I know you're a graduate of Southwestern Christian College. Been preaching for how long?
Been preaching for 14 years. 14 years been preaching. Was baptized in 2000. Started preaching in 2001. Amen.
What a blessing. What a blessing. Amen. And how has your ministry been since then?
Ministry's been great, man. It has certainly been one of development, children, experience. I've traveled, had an opportunity to work in a number of different settings. Midwest, the South, and also in the Northeast. So it's been a great ministry.
Well, delighted that you preaching the gospel. This is something that I believe that a lot of young people, young men, should be engaged in, is telling about the good news of Jesus Christ. And, you know, I'm just delighted to hear preachers like you, young preachers who proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. It tells me that the church has a future to show what's going on. You on today, and tell us what your lesson was again, and how you felt that the response was to what you delivered.
Well, man, morning I had the opportunity to speak from Matthew chapter 8, where we see Jesus calming the storm, and I spoke from the subject of sticking with Jesus in a stormy sea. Ever-changing world. So one of the things that I had an opportunity to really do was to spend time looking at the incarnate word, Jesus, the fact that as Christians, if we're going to navigate the unpredictable situations of life, as life in this world is always ever-changing, the best way and I hope we find is in Jesus Christ. So we have to have the ability to and the fortitude to stick to our faith, to trust Jesus, and to live out the word that we see him express and demonstrate in Scripture.
Certainly was a great lesson. I like the concept that you brought forth in the lesson, and I'm sure that it was well received by the audience. Now, what do we expect from the rest of this lectureship? The crowd tonight has been, you know, fantastic. I mean, if we look in the audience, I'm thinking we have over 500 people here on this evening. It means that something is happening here. Something is happening here. What do you expect when you prepare a message like that and you present it? You know, what do you expect that people will take from this lectureship back to their different congregations?
Well, man, anytime we come together, just like with this lectureship, I'm just privileged to have the opportunity to, as a young preacher, up and coming, to have an opportunity to just brag on Jesus, share my faith. But I think that our coming together, as Brother Harrison said earlier, as we look back at the idea that was set forth for the lectureship, was to help the members, to help the church. And I think as we focus this year on the word and the sturdiness of the word and the unchanging of the word, we can really learn here that in the midst of a changing environment that we now live in our society, that we just need to stick with the word. And also I think people from every lesson that's preached this week, from every speaker that speaks with his personality, with his gifts and his ability, every woman speaker that speaks to our sisters will somehow ignite the fire within members to want to have a hunger for studying the word. And so as preaching, we don't have much time. It's very limited time. Any time we have preaching opportunity. But what we aim to do as preachers, teachers and as teachers is simply to open a door or to introduce people to a room so that later on they may be able to explore that room further once that door has been opened by the shining of the light of revelation. So I think certainly people can gain that from this on this week.
Well, certainly. I really, really hope that, the message got across and is getting across. We have a few more days to go in this lectureship, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday in this lectureship. There's so much to be gained. There are so many great gospel preachers on this lectureship. We look forward to hearing more. Tonight was a really stellar lineup. You know, these guys showed up and they showed out.
Yeah, they did.
Certainly,
I was glad I got out of the way early.
I can just imagine it's hard to get up behind preachers like these and you know to make sure that everybody's blood pressure is down when you do. But you did yourself proud. You did a fantastic job.
Thank
and we're
God.
Proud of you as a young preacher and you know just want to pray with you and for you, encourage you to keep on the work going. Tell me before you go, before we break this interview, Orlando, what's the work like in Liberty City? What's the community like? You know what are some of the things that you guys are doing there to impact the community and in particular our young people?
Amen. Well, man, we are presented with a unique atmosphere. We are in a very urban community. We're in the heart of what is known as Liberty City proper within the city of Miami. Miami is divided into sections. Liberty City in particular serves a higher demographic of what we would call minority families. And so we have a distinct privilege of being placed in a place where we believe ministry really is budding with potential, pregnant with opportunity. And so what we do is we try to just be a church, man, that gets into the community and connects with the local community, to let them know that the church is more than just members who meet on Sunday, but we're engaged in relevant ministries to where we're feeding the community, ministries to where we are tutoring kids or giving children opportunities through our partnerships with the 100 Black Men of South Florida and the Honey Shine through the Alonzo Mourning, Tracy Mourning Foundation. So we have those distinct privileges to touch young lives. We participate with those particular foundations every year, and we bring young people along who can participate in shopping sprees and going on trips all across the country to get exposure. One of the greatest issues that we deal with in our particular community, in urban communities, is the issue of poverty. And because the people are in amongst what is a poverty setting, they come with impoverished mentalities. And that is a challenge that we face as a church. But through our partnerships, through opportunities God has presented unto us, has given us a tremendous opportunity to really take advantage of those things. And so certainly we do the best we can, and we know with God, by the grace of God, we'll just continue to do better and better as He presents those opportunities before us.
All right, great work. Give a shout out to those who might be watching on OCTN who are from the Miami Gardens area, the Liberty City area. Tell them exactly where you're located and tell them your times of service and how they can get in touch with the Liberty City Church.
Amen. Well, it's good to be here once again. And for all those who watch, and we certainly would like to invite you out where we serve at the Liberty City Church of Christ there in Miami, Florida, in particular Liberty City Community at 1263 Northwest 67th Street. We meet on Sundays at 8 a.m. Our Bible class is at 10:15. Also evening worship at 5 o'clock, and we meet midweek on Tuesday night at 7 p.m. We'd love to have you come out as we explore the Word of God, as we fellowship with one another, and most of all, as we lift up the mighty name of God in Jesus Christ, our Savior. Love to have you. Thank you for watching, and certainly be encouraged, and may you be blessed.
Thank you so much for joining us on the set. We appreciate you taking the time out to come and be with us on the set. And we, as I said, we want to continue to pray with you and for you and the work that you're doing. And we ask that you do the same for OCTN. And certainly anything that we can do from our standpoint to make sure that you know, the work is enhanced in Liberty City, and that the word is spread, please feel free to let us know, and we will see how best we can work it and make sure that the word gets out on OCTN.TV. So once again, thank you for joining us, and have yourselves a wonderful rest of the evening. So thank you again for joining us on OCTN. You have been blessed today by just what is happening here at the Grand Ballroom, the 42nd annual Southeastern Lectureship. Been a wonderful, wonderful day, and I'm sure that you have been blessed, and we certainly want to continue to bring this to you. So please join us again tomorrow morning. The program starts at 8:45, but you can join us at 9 a.m. where we will do it all over again and bring you more spiritual food that will bless your soul and keep you on the right track as we try to make heaven our home. May God bless you, and join us tomorrow on OCTN.TV.
Thank you. Yeah, man.
Yeah.
Also, here's another announcement I need to give you. The board members for the Southeastern Lectureship will meet in room 1310 tonight. Now, so don't get too upset with us board members, but we need to meet with the board members of the Southeastern Lectureship tonight. And we need to meet you guys in room 1310 tonight, Brother Dr. Harrison. 1310 tonight. And we're going to ask you to bring your family with you as well. Everybody, all the board members, bring their family, because we have a reception that we're going to give for the board members in room 13 and 10. So if you are thinking about becoming a board member, don't think about that tonight. It's just for the ones that's already boy, I've been thinking for the longest, but it's just for tonight. So I'm thinking that I have made all of the announcements. Okay, yes, I have one other announcement, and this is from bring that on up, brother. If you insure finances, if you have signed up with them, we have a drawing tonight. I hope you brought your tickets. And tomorrow night as well. If you go by the desk and you just fill out the paperwork, or just information, this is concerning financial planning for life insurance and other different things. This fine brother here is he's giving out gifts. He's giving out gifts. So if you have your card, if you have done that, if you have not done it, you can do it tomorrow. But these are the numbers, and these are for what? The yellow tickets are for what? Okay, public gift cards, the yellow cards. It's for public gift cards.
And meet us at the table to pick them up.
Okay, meet them at the table. I need to do this now. 893-762. I'm going to call the last three numbers, 762. Okay, you don't have to say bingo. Just make sure you go out there. 791. Okay, God bless you. Okay. If you didn't win, blame Brother Tucker. 811. Let me get this other yellow one. Okay, this one is still for the good. Okay. 690-647. This is the red one. 690-648. These are for the gift cards for $5 from Publix. And this is anybody needing the gas while you're in St. Petersburg. This is a gift card for gas. 810 for $25. 810. Okay, go by the table, please. Thank you, brother. We appreciate that so very much. Once again, we want to thank you so very much for being here tonight, being a part of this session. We also want you to remember the OCTN-TV. Okay, make sure you text that information in, OCTN-TV. Once again, we want to thank you for coming. Thank you for being a part. Let's start off early in the morning. Let's please come for the workshops and for the sessions early in the morning. God's willing, we'll see everyone in the morning. Let us please stand.
Would you pray, excuse me, would you pray with me, please? Our God and our Father, we thank you so much for your kindness. We thank you for allowing us to travel the distances we have to assemble here this evening. We thank you for the fellowship, the spirit that's among us. We thank you for the tremendous sacrifice that you have made for us by your Son. Most of all, Father, we thank you for the continuing relationship that we can have with you for what has already been done. Father, we've been challenged to live in the moment, to be grown up, to really consider those things, to be joyful each and every day. Help us to do that while we're here and to be full enough to take it back with us. But bless us this evening, Father. We know some of those that are hurting, physically, emotionally, spiritually, that you'll just strengthen them. Help them to have a good night's rest, Father. Just watch over us. Father, we thank you. Thank you for all that you do. Help us to strive to bring glory through this event and all that we do each and every day. And we ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.